I know I haven't been here for about 3 weeks for various reasons, one of which was my right foot. But part of what I do for the church is to have guest musicians come in once a week, because after a while, you don't want to hear me play all the time. It's great to have new musicians and give a different perspective on music. When I first came to Ahihik just under 4 years ago, one of the first local musicians that I heard were our guest artists today. I was so impressed with their music and their talent that they have become, and they are, of course, a real fabric of music in this community. So it is great pleasure for me to introduce Black String in a performance of Tango for Claude by Richard Galliano. Please welcome Victor and Ignacio Garcia. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Colleen Berry, and I'll be leading today's service. Reverend Matt Alspaugh will be presenting from North Carolina this morning. Our opening words this morning are by Reverend Dr. Rebecca Savage. Rejoice. Rejoice with full hearts, beloved people of blessing. Rejoice. May this time of worship celebrate what we know at our core. Blessings are real and ours to claim and radiate. Blessings are abundant and ours to revel in and pass along. Blessings are transformational and ours to be challenged by as we grow toward the faith we know we can be. Rejoice. And so I want to welcome you with live from Fellowship Hall. It's our LCUUF Sunday service. Our announcements were on a slide before the service. If you didn't see them, don't worry. They were sent out by email with the order of service for today. They're in your inbox. A few notes. Our building is now open for in-person services. We continue to offer our service on Zoom each Sunday for those who are unable to attend in person. Wearing masks in the fellowship building is now encouraged, but not required. And a special announcement, next week we are having an all-fellowship lunch at Adelita's after the service. But you need to sign up either here at the table outside or by sending an email to Sue Kelly. Her email should be on the screen. We hope to see all of you there. And now a special welcome to our visitors. If you are visiting with us for the first time or have returned after a long absence, we invite you to say your name and tell us where you're from. If you're on Zoom, use the Zoom raise hand feature or just wave your hand and we'll ask you to unmute. If you're in the room, just raise your hand. We'll start with the people in the room. Do we have anyone here new or returning after a visit? Good.
Thank you for having me. I am Chris and I am from Houston and I'm here in Ahihik from June through August, and this is my first time ever at a Unitarian church.
Welcome, Chris. We're glad you're with us.
My name is Bridget. Thank you for being so welcoming. I come here for about half the year twice, and the other half live in Richmond, Virginia. And I was attracted especially today because I've been following Richard Rohr's writing for a couple of years.
Welcome, Bridget. Glad you're with us. And are there any visitors here with us on Zoom this morning?
I don't see anyone with their hand raised.
Okay, thank you, Richard. Our chalice lighting words today are by Reverend Suzelle Lynch. The flame we kindle in the chalice of faith holds blessings of warmth and light and life-giving energy. It shines forth a beacon to us at home. It lights up our longings to connect and to share. It possesses the power to shape a world where equity and compassion reign supreme. May this warmth and light and life-giving energy celebrate the blessings we have claimed and help us extend them in hands and hearts that offer these blessings to all. Now let us light our chalice with these words that we sing together.
We kindle this light in celebration.
Our opening hymn is Spirit of Life. Please rise as you are able and join me in singing.
Spirit of Life, come. shape of justice, roots hold me close, wings set me free. Spirit of life, come to me, come to me.
Each week we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. We do this by sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives. First, let us recall the joys, whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others. You on Zoom are welcome to type joys in the chat box, and we will read those aloud. But we'll start with the folks here. Are there any joys that people would like to share here in the room?
I'm Kat Barnett, and my joy this morning is that we're just back from Texas visiting family, and my older son, who now lives in Boston, came down to pick up his car that he had left there for a year, and his brother and he drove it up, back up to Boston, giving them, they're both unemployed at this moment, and so now they have some time together. I was really happy to hear that.
Hi, I'm Barley Donahue, and I wanted to share that my husband is in San Antonio, Texas, celebrating Juneteenth.
Hi, I'm Michael. Yesterday and on Friday, the Lake Chapala Orchestra, which I helped found 4 years ago, gave their best ever performance. The very first time that we did a traditional symphony concert with overture, concerto, and followed by a symphony, we sold it out for two performances. The orchestra, some of which believed that we couldn't possibly do this piece when we started rehearsing a few weeks ago, rose to the occasion. And I have to say that in my life as a professional musician, this is going to be one of the most memorable occasions to see this orchestra rise to the challenge and give the joy of music to the community.
Good morning, I'm Heidi, and I've been away for a few days with the opportunity to visit Helen and Bill White. And all of you who know her, some of them, you folks are on Zoom right now, I extend their best wishes to all of you, and they look forward to seeing you probably around the beginning of August. And in the meantime, just to share what I saw there, is their beautiful homestead, the acres of land that they owned and have donated to make trails available to the community. I just can't tell you the genealogical research that Helen has done to help the community remember all of what's gone on there since 1845 when her family first moved there. Helen, congratulations, and thank you for a very memorable and wonderful visit.
It was a joy to hear the musicians this morning. It's just really wonderful. And I was also at the concert the other day, and when I saw in advance the agenda, I thought, well, that's a little ambitious. But no, they knocked it out of the park. It was really good.
I just want to share the joy that I've been fortunate to have in my life with some amazing dads, all the way back to my grandfather, Lester Durkee, my uncle, Stephen Durkee, my dad, Ed Clark, and my husband, Bob Kelly. So happy Father's Day in heaven to all four of them, and to all the dads here and on Zoom and everywhere, because you guys, you have an important job. Thank you for doing it.
And I have a joy that my brother Michael made it across country, driving from Santa Rosa, California, where he had lived for almost forever, to North Carolina, where they have moved. And he drove cross country with a little teardrop trailer with no air conditioning, a tortoise, a desert tortoise, and his crazy little Shih Tzu. So I'm glad he's there in one piece. Now, do we have any joys to share on Zoom?
Yes, from Al Castleman. Our joy on Wednesday, June 15th, Jane and I celebrated our 59th wedding anniversary. And that's it for the joys. Let me make one more quick check. That's it for the joys.
Thank you, Richard. Now let us voice our sorrows or concerns, whatever you or the world may be holding that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts. Those of you on Zoom are welcome to type your sorrows or concerns in the chat box. Again, we'll start with the folks here in the room. Are there any sorrows or concerns that people would like to share here in the room?
I have a concern for a little tyke in Bogota, Colombia. It's a very, she's like 2.5, and she has pneumonia, and she's in the hospital, and so we're in and out of ICU. So I have a concern her, but she is rallying, and it looks like things are going to improve.
I have a concern, which is two of my best friends, we call ourselves the Three Musketeers, are both ill. One had surgery, major surgery, and the other just got COVID. So they're wishing I were there in California to take care of them, and I'm sorry. Wishing Liza and Krista well. Are there any sorrows to be shared on Zoom?
Yes, there are. From Helen White, Bill and I want to light a candle of sorrow in memory of John Rome, an early member of the fellowship. He and Mary came to Ahihic for many years and influenced Bill and I to move here. Members may remember John and Mary always wore matching t-shirts. John died last week while he was exercising at the assisted living facility where he and Mary had recently moved. I think he was 94. And she says, also, we are looking forward to our return to Mexico. The weather is terrible, over 90 degrees with no end in sight. And then from Kathy Coaches, a friend in Vancouver, Susie, had her house burned to the ground on Thursday. She, her daughter, and all the pets got out alive, but the house she lived in for 40 years and all the contents are gone. Please send her some good thoughts. And that's it.
Let's have a moment of silence for all those in need of it. And this candle from our care team represents those sorrows that are too raw, too difficult for us to share aloud. So many of us have had losses, partners, children, grandchildren, pets, losses that remain present with us every day. So many of us have burdens, anger, fear, and frustration, all of those things that weigh heavy on our hearts. We light this candle for all those unspoken sorrows.
Blessed is every breath I take. Blessed is every fear I face. Blessed is every robin's nest. Blessed is every bough of spruce. Blessed is every shell on the beach. Blessed is the lap of the waves. Blessed is the droop of a willow. Blessed is the sweep of the prairie. Blessed is the gable of my house. Blessed are my family and friends. Blessed is my love, the depth of my strength, which is deeper than my present brokenness. Blessed is the honesty of my fear and my fierce love of life. Blessed is love that forever remembers my future and trembles with my tremors. Blessed is the courage I did not know I had. Blessed is my desire that I might speak unfettered. Blessed is the song of life, one of whose notes is me. Blessed is the beauty of it all. Blessed is my thanksgiving. And blessed is my dream of peace for all those I love, beginning with myself. Amen.
Today's reading is a daily meditation by Father Richard Rohr, a Catholic priest, and is entitled Original Blessing. Yet another gift of Native and Celtic spirituality is their unashamed welcome of some kind of original blessing instead of starting with a problem like original sin. Pelagius, born in the year 345 and died in 418, one of the early Christian Celtic writers, opposed the doctrine of original sin coined by his contemporary Augustine. Pelagius saw that beginning with the negative, original sin, would damage rather than aid spiritual development. Beginning with the positive instead of a problem is the healthiest and most hopeful way to find wholeness. The Celts saw creation as good and as a theophany or revelation of God's very being, just as Genesis had taught. Those who live in close proximity to the natural world seem to come to know the universe as benevolent much more easily, despite its inherent violence and changeability. This belief leads to a very different value than when your whole worldview begins with a theological or moral problem to be solved. Genesis began with six clear statements of original blessing or inherent goodness. This is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 10 through 31. And the words original sin are not in the New Testament. Yet the church became so preoccupied with the fly in the ointment, the flaw in the beauty, that we forgot and even missed out on any original blessing. We saw Jesus primarily as a problem solver rather than a revealer of the very heart and image of God. That's from Colossians chapter 1, verse 15f. We must now rebuild on a foundation of original goodness and not on a foundation of original curse or sin. We dug a pit so deep that most people and most theologies could not get back out of it. You must begin with a yes. You cannot begin with a no, or it's not a beginning at all. The video we'll now see is by Matthew Fox, who is an Anglican priest.
Matthew Fox, in 1988, you wrote a letter to then Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger and the whole church, calling the Catholic Church a dysfunctional family. What happened after that? How did that go?
Well, they kind of proved my point. They came after me. They silenced me for a year. And then eventually they kicked me out of the Dominican Order, of which I'd been a member for 34 years. It wasn't just that letter. It was also my book called Original Blessing, mm-hmm. which I learned from the response to that, that the Vatican at that time really has an investment in original sin, really, big time. And even though I proved in my book and other theologians have spoken about sins, it's not in the Bible. No Jews ever believed in original sin, and Jesus was a Jew. So what's this thing called original sin? We started in the 4th century with Augustine, St. Augustine. And of course, the 4th century also is a century the church inherited the empire. So if you're going to run an empire, original sin is a great idea. It gets everyone in a pretzel about whether they have a right to be here and whether they're beautiful or not, etc. And I also think, frankly, that capitalism, consumer capitalism, is built on an ideology of original sin. Because saying you don't have what it takes, you got to buy some kind of external savior, that you don't have what it takes. But the truth is, I mean, look at the universe, 13.8 billion years it's been operating. We've come along very late. We now know it's, 2 trillion galaxies big, each galaxy having hundreds of billions of stars. I mean, it's an amazing being that's been going on for all this time. We've been invited aboard. It's an original blessing. It's a blessing.
This is the time in our service when we ask that you remember that we share our gifts here through pledging and donations. Instructions for payments to the fellowship are on a slide during the announcements before the service each week. For people here at the fellowship, we'll pass a basket. And while you're considering your gifts to the fellowship, remember that each month LCUUF donates 5,000 pesos or more to an organization in our Lakeside community. We share one half of the offering collected at the fellowship each week with that organization. For the month of June, we are supporting Food Bank Lakeside. Food Bank Lakeside works to relieve the chronic food poverty of our most disadvantaged neighbors, collaborating with donors, volunteers, businesses, and community organizations to ease suffering and offer the hope of a brighter future throughout the Lakeside community. If you're not attending the fellowship in person, please donate to share the basket when you pay your pledge. Donate to share the basket separately or indicate what part of your offering is for share the basket. The offering will now be received.
One of the hardest things for me about putting together a service is coming up with the title. Now, sometimes the title just pops and everything clicks. The whole service just flows from that title. We'll see if that's the case with this service, Original Blessing. Now, this service came out because I encountered that brief reading we heard earlier called Original Blessing by the Christian theologian and mystic Richard Rohr. The message quite resonated with me, for I, like many of you, was raised in a Christian faith and later on discovered Unitarian Universalism. Now, many of us have walked completely away from our Christian past, not looking back. I did that for a while. But I've come to realize that there are things about that past that are worth reevaluating, reexamining. It's almost like therapy, going back, looking at our childhood, looking at our shadow qualities, trying to make sense of why we are the way we are, and trying to become better people. I look at my religious past in the same way, trying to make sense of it, trying to see how it affects me even today. So while I don't consider myself a Christian, I do cherish what I can from my past. So back to that title. As I was planning the service, I rediscovered a book on my shelf titled Original Blessing. It's by another Christian mystic and theologian, Matthew Fox. I was surprised at the similarity of thinking by both Rohr and Fox, both Catholic priests, both associated with monastic orders, Franciscan and Dominican, respectively. Both of them founded religious institutions. Both ran afoul of the church hierarchy for their teachings and ideas. And Fox, in particular, was excommunicated from the Catholic Church. And both Rohr and Fox had similar things to say about this idea of original blessing, as we will see. So what is this original blessing, and how did it become to be a controversial thing? Now, I started my theological training at LCUUF Theological School, a Methodist seminary, and later transferred to Starr King School for the Ministry, a Unitarian Universalist school. Now, there were just a handful of us UUs studying at LCUUF among a sea of Christians of varying denominations. But the professors generally loved having us UUs in their classes with our diverse views, and comfort with stirring things up. This was especially the case in the required medieval Christianity class. Now, much of that class was devoted to all the councils and doctrinal pronouncements as the early church tried to sort out and enforce doctrine and root out heretical ideas. We UUs were often quite willing to side with the heretics. As we reminded people, the word heresy comes from the Greek, meaning to choose. And we UUs were certainly all about choosing our theology. So one example of a heresy is the teaching of Pelagius, that 5th century Celtic Christian monk, whom Rohr mentioned in the reading. Pelagius argued against the doctrine of original sin, that idea that we are all born sinful. Pelagius reasoned that if God created humanity, and if everything God created was good, then there was no way we were tainted with original sin. This came to be seen as a very heretical idea, and Pelagius was condemned in various church councils, and he was ultimately excommunicated by the Pope in the year 418. But what is original sin, and why did it come about? Well, if you're a psychologically abusive person and you're trying to gaslight somebody in order to control them, you might convince them that they are somehow messed up, broken, incomplete, imperfect, and further, that you and only you can make them complete and perfect. Original sin is a lot like that. It's the idea that we're all imperfect, broken, and we were born that way. And there's nothing we can do about it, except through Christ or God, or certainly only through the church. As Rohr and Fox both point out, the idea of original sin is not biblical. It wasn't in the Hebrew Bible, nor was it taught by Jesus or his early followers. Original sin arose later, mostly formulated by Augustine, a key leader of the early church, though plenty of other early leaders piled on. Why would they do this? It seems like such a horrible idea. But you see, the early church was still in a precarious place. It had been suppressed for a long time. But in the 4th century, the church was able to cozy up with the Roman Emperor Constantine, shown here on the left, and it became the approved religion of the Roman Empire. But the church still had to win over people in power, and it did so by adopting and speaking the language of power. A theology like original sin, where everyone is evil, sinful, but we have the solution, is just that kind of language. It's much easier to control people if you tell them they are bad, that they are failures, than if you tell them that they are good and they are powerful. As both Rohr and Fox point out, this alternative theology of original blessing is the idea that we are all created good, even perfect. Not only does this idea appear to be what Jesus taught, but it appears that the theologies of a great many of other religious traditions have something similar. Rohr points out that the Celts and many native spiritualities began with a positive point of view of our humanity living in a benevolent universe. And Fox, too, finds this idea of original blessing in the teachings of Taoist, Sufi, Wiccan, and Native American traditions. And I want to be clear that while many Christians are still wedded to the idea of original sin, a great many others, like Fox and like Rohr, and like friends of mine in progressive, mostly mainline Christian traditions, reject original sin and find something like original blessing to be much more sensible. I even suspect that many of the Catholic nuns I knew, the liberal ones at least, would agree. I would also include Unitarian Universalist Christians in this crowd. And yes, we do have UU Christians. In fact, I think the idea of original blessing aligns very well with our UU affirmation of the inherent worth and dignity of every person. We've long felt that people carry an inherent goodness, even from birth. It is only through interaction with the world, perhaps, more specifically with human constructions and institutions, imperfect that they are, that people become bruised and broken, and so that they might act out in sinful ways, so to speak. But underneath, at our core, we are all originally blessed. This song, Everything is Holy Now, is by a Unitarian Universalist singer-songwriter, Peter Meyer. And I think that was Colleen's words, but sorry.
When I was a boy each week, Sunday we would go to church and pay attention to the priest. He would read the holy word and consecrate the holy bread, and everyone would kneel and bow. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy. In Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two, and Jesus made the water wine. And I remember feeling sad, miracles don't happen still. Now I can't keep track, 'cause everything's a miracle. Everything, everything, everything's a miracle. Wine from water is not so small, but an even better magic trick is that anything is here at all. So the challenging thing becomes to look for miracles, to find in where there isn't one. When holy water was rare at best, it barely wet my fingertips, but now I have to hold my breath. Tennessee again. It used to be a world half there, heaven's second rate hand me down, but I walk it with a reverent air, 'cause everything is holy now. Testament, that'd be very hard to say. See another new morning come, say it's not a sacrament. I tell you that it can't be done. This morning outside I stood, saw a little red-winged bird shining like a burning bush and singing like a scripture verse. It made me want to bow my head. I remember when church let out, how things have changed since then. Everything is holy now. It used to be a world half there, heaven's second rate hand me down, but I walk it with a reverent air, 'cause everything is holy now.
Everything is holy now. Everything is blessed. So what does original blessing look like in our world? In his book, Original Blessing, Matthew Fox describes four spiritual paths and some 26 themes. Now, he notes that he didn't invent these four paths, but rather noted them as he studied the writings of various mystics looking for a common pattern. He calls these paths the positive way, the negative way, the creative way, and the transformative way. I mention these by name today only because last week, Richard Clark spoke here about the four yogas of Hindu spirituality: action, devotion, meditation, and knowledge. I suspect there are parallels here, but I leave it to you to explore if you want. And I won't delve into the 26 themes. They are more like freestanding reflections on various topics, among them creation, faith, trust, pain, eroticism, compassion, humility. It's quite a collection. But instead, let me reflect, riff on, if you will, a few other ideas that might line up with this concept of original blessing. We might start with our relationship with the earth, with the universe. Certainly many philosophical and religious views see the earth as impure, broken, even dirty. But as Peter Meyer tells us in his childhood church, it used to be a world half there, heaven's second-rate hand-me-down. But that's not true for him today, because everything, everything is holy now. Everything, all the way back to the beginning. There is no split between heaven and earth. There is no dualism. All is one. Everything, including us, is holy. everything is blessed. As Richard Rohr said, those who live in close proximity to the natural world seem to come to know the universe as benevolent much more easily, despite its inherent violence and changeability. Perhaps this is why Indigenous people tend to have a greater respect for the natural world, why their religions tend to embrace the world rather than push it away. And I think also of our scientific understanding of nature, of evolution and ecology. We're coming to realize that nature is not simply red and tooth and claw, though that's certainly part of the story. But in addition to competition, we're learning that surprising examples of cooperation, even interspecies cooperation, exists. I think of the forest ecologist, Suzanne Simard, at the University of British Columbia, who studies how trees in the Pacific Northwest have evolved to cooperate with each other, even with trees of other species. The trees communicate underground, connected with fungal networks, which allow them to share food and water, the stronger supporting the weaker, the taller trees nourishing the smaller trees growing in their shade. They even have the ability to share information with one another, warning of predators, so that nearby trees can respond, perhaps by increasing the production of poisons in their leaves, or even attracting insects that will attack their predators. We're learning that the world, the universe, is far more complicated, interconnected than we once thought. This is no hand-me-down world. It is, as Rohr tells us, inherently good. Now, a second idea might be larger and more controversial. What are the places of various people based on superficial qualities like gender, age, race, body form, and so on? The Catholic Church, along with conservative Protestant churches, have long held a hierarchical view of the world based on the ancient Aristotelian chain of being. They put God on top, then angels, then men below God, and women below men, then children and slaves, yes, slaves, then animals and plants below that. So no wonder there's a huge conflict over a wide variety of topics these days that threaten this order. Third wave feminism, LGBTQ rights, freedoms for transgender people, non-binary gender identity, reproductive rights, all these things are tremendously threatening to religious conservatives, to the point that many of them whine that they are the oppressed ones, that their religious freedom is being denied. What religious freedom? Why the freedom to impose their beliefs on others? But consider more subtle formulations of this hierarchy. I mentioned children as having a pretty low place on the chain of being. And our north of the border societies reflect this hierarchy especially. You've probably seen or heard about the series Old Enough on Netflix. It chronicles the stories of children as young as 2 years old, going out alone to run their first errands, going to the grocery store for a few items, for example. They're doing this in Japan, not in the West, of course. Now, Old Enough is a reality show, so it stretches the truth a little bit. But it is true that in Japan, kids at 6 years old are often out on the street alone running errands or going to school. Kids are much more independent and have more responsibility than most Western kids. And what surprised me was the vehement reactions of Western people about this show, that these kids are somehow in danger, that Western society could never be arranged so that little kids could safely leave their homes without a parent. What I see in this reaction is an unconscious agreement with that chain of being hierarchy. Children must be put and kept in their place. But can we imagine a world where children are blessed too? A world where children are seen as people with inherent worth and dignity, where each child is given the freedom and responsibility and an invitation to mature at their own rate. Finally, this week I read a piece about Jack Welch, the CEO of General Electric for two decades, starting in 1981. Welch grew the company to be the biggest in the world and has been lauded as the very model of a corporate chief executive. Now I remember studying Welch and General Electric in business school. I did not find his management style at all appealing, growing through acquisitions, outsourcing, offshore manufacturing, and financial gamesmanship. Once a great American industrial giant, GE pivoted under Welch into a financial services company. Now it has foundered, losing much of its value, and it soon will be broken up. Welch was the poster child for the go-go capitalism, which became endemic in the 1980s. Maximizing shareholder value was the only concern. Forget about anything else. Ignore employee retention, research and development, environmental concerns, global warming. And this concept caught on and became the basis for capitalism worldwide. I remember briefly working for a Chinese-based telecom company. And at an annual meeting, our CEO announced that the corporate goal for the coming year, the singular goal, was to make her worth $100 million. Maximizing shareholder value. I soon found another job. I believe Matthew Fox is right, that this particular style of hardline capitalism is a kind of original sin. It's at the heart of many of the world's problems today. It's certainly the source of growing inequality between the poor and the rich, the loss of job security, and the gig economy. I believe that economic inequality and insecurity is driving many of the other tensions in our society, such as the rise of populism and authoritarianism. The pandemic has exposed many other problems, among them supply chain issues, lack of local reserves. I mean, can't we have more than one plant in the whole USA that makes baby formula? This hard capitalism has become ideology, even idolatry. Just as the early Christian church got into bed with the Roman Empire, selling its soul with ideas like original sin, I think many of the modern day conservative churches are cozying up to hard capitalism for power and profit. And over time, we've learned some things about capitalism. We know that capitalism does not automatically foster democracy. China is the example here. We know that capitalism does not automatically foster a rule of law. Russia is the example here. We know that capitalism does not automatically raise all boats. The USA is the example here. So our challenge in imagining a world of original blessing, a world where everyone counts, is not to ask too much of capitalism. Maybe capitalism can help make people prosperous, but we have to find other ways of achieving larger goals, things like democracy, justice, peace, equality. I'm not sure what those other ways are, but I think looking at recent history might be helpful to uncover them. Richard Rohr said at the end of the reading, "We must now rebuild on a foundation of original goodness and not on a foundation of original curse or sin." What if we lived in a world of original blessing, a world where everyone counted, a world where everyone, each of us, strove to live in harmony with each other in the earth, and a world where our institutions, our governments, organizations, schools, and businesses all work to support that desire for harmony with each other and the earth. Matthew Fox said at the end of his book, We all share creation in common. We all share responsibility for that creation. Therefore, we are called to recreate. And I can think of no better place to begin this recreation than with religion itself, end quote. So that is our task as religious people, to begin the process of recreation of this world, a world we understand is filled with original blessing. As Rohr said, you must begin with yes. And so let us begin with yes. Let us make this our task in ways small and large, in our breathing and in our doing, to live into this world of original blessing. Choose to bless the world. Blessed be.
Our closing hymn is Come Sing a Song with Me. Please rise as you are able and join me in singing. Now about miracles. Peter Meyer tells us that now he can't keep track because everything is a miracle. Everything is a miracle. Isn't that true? In a universe that is born with original blessing, everything, the world around us, our existence, our connections with one another, our love and our being love, it's all a miracle. It's all holy. It's all blessed. Let us extinguish our chalices with these words, which we read together. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world.
And now it gives me great pleasure to welcome once again to close our service in a performance of Ashitaka Seki by Joe Hisashi. Please welcome Victor and Ignacio Garcia.